Hello everyone and welcome to NewTek TV. I am your host Richard Evans and today's topic is remote learning. Now earlier in 2020, schools were forced to shut down over spring break, leaving teachers and students scrambling on how to resume their normal teaching routines. Today, we're going to speak to some of the staff at Medford, Oregon Public Schools who use NewTek products to help them get back on the road to teaching. Now during today's broadcast, if you have any questions, please type them into our chat window where a NewTek sales specialist is standing by to help you out. And you can also sign up for a free NewTek product demonstration by visiting newtek.tv and clicking on the demo button at the top of the page. Now let's take a look at how Medford, Oregon Public Schools quickly pivoted to a remote learning workflow.
My name is Ivan Olinghouse, and I am an electives teacher here at Hedrick Middle School in Medford, Oregon. We're nestled here in the Rogue Valley, a relatively rural part of the country, and we were about a week away from spring break. So we prepared for, you know, extended spring break. Everybody packed their things up on Friday the 13th of March. The next Monday, we all got the word we weren't coming back to school. It was a few days into that that we realized that we were going to have to implement something new, something different for our distance learning programs.
We pivoted to distance learning. We had no choice. The thing that set us apart was we had then this opportunity for our kids with just an antenna to be able to see their teacher on TV. Just a lot of fun learning opportunities for our students.
We decided that we needed to upgrade to something better, and that's when we went with using a Tricaster that we had here in the district. And when we switched to that Tricaster, that solved a lot of the technical problems that we were running into.
The week after spring break, we set it up in the middle of the library, and we got better cameras, and we set everything up anew. We got a bigger green screen. Then we hit the ground running. We filmed like 15 lesson plans in our first full week of production, and we sent those lesson plans to the station.
I don't think we were really fully aware of what was going to happen. I thought once we knew that we would be shifting to a completely different type of learning, I went into full gear of what can I do to connect with my kids.
Preschool isn't about academics. It's all about connection and relationships and the social and emotional components. And so if we can't see them, how are we going to keep connection? And so right then it was like, get your guitar, film content, get it on YouTube, start getting this out into the world.
Then we decided to make the leap together, and we came up with a couple of different ideas for these TV programs. We were able to do a black and white screen for the mystery episode. We had one of our teachers, Teacher Zane, actually fly in because of the green screen behind us.
Eventually it got to the point where we were hearing from people from Chicago and New York and other places that had their kids tuning in.
As we've gathered feedback, and we have gathered a lot of feedback from our parents and from our teachers, we've heard that parents are interested in choice. What they are now looking for is, here are some options. What makes most sense for your kid? And so at a very basic level, as we open back up, we're using that feedback to give options for parents and for students, what works for them.
To be able to film tele-course lesson plans that kind of emulate the classroom, and with cameras and mix effects and audio, you can really create a richer education environment for students at home. I personally think that it's an integral part to the milieu of options that they have for distance learning here in Southern Oregon and nationwide.
I believe if you're looking for long-term sustainability and keeping folks engaged, you need to have a product that is able to have multiple views and different angles and things that us, me, layman people, don't know that magic that's actually happening, but we know it's not some simple cell phone that's recording the thing. And so we know that engaging people is a difficult task to do on video, and so whatever tools can help with that, we are always interested in exploring.
I really believe when this has opened the eyes of a lot of people to opportunity, and we can offer a dual learning situation where kids don't necessarily have to go to a brick and mortar school to get what they need from their teachers. They can stay home and click and have supplemental learning via television, via videos. My hope is we're all back in our classrooms. I mean, that's where my heart longs to be. But the gift of all of this has been so monumental that if we had to return to this, I would do it in a heartbeat.
Joining us now is Ivan Allinghaus, electives teacher at Hedrick Middle School, and Ben Garcia from PBS. Gentlemen, welcome to NewTek TV.
Hi.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Okay, so Friday the 13th happens. You pack up your stuff for spring break, then you find out later that class will not be resuming as normal. How much time did you have to implement this new remote learning workflow?
Well, first of all, Friday the 13th was an early leave to spring break. They extended spring break by 2 weeks. And then the week after, the only thing that we knew was that we were going to have a 2-week spring break. And I knew that I was kind of out of a job in the sense that my normal workflow was working with Ivan and a few other teachers to implement student reporting labs, which is a PBS NewsHour project. And the school district contacted me and first the following Wednesday and said, hey, what would you think about doing some sort of a project with us, film telecourses, and air them on your station's air? And I told them, well, I can't make that decision, but let's have a meeting. So we had a meeting with Brad, our content director, myself, and the communications director at Medford School District, and kind of started to work out the beginning aspects of the plan. And then it was by the end of the week, I called Ivan and asked him if he'd be willing to work double overtime and help us out with this project starting the week after, which was the real week of spring break. And he graciously accepted. And we met at Hedrick here at the school the Monday of spring break, of real spring break, and started assessing the situation, what equipment we had, what we could do with it, et cetera.
Oh, so that was a pretty short turnaround. That's pretty awesome. Wow. So when starting off with this, like what kind of hardware, like cameras, microphones, lights, did you already have to get this up and running, or did you have to outsource any of this hardware?
Yeah, we have a small middle school level studio here at Hedrick. We were running off of some software-based applications, off of a nice Mac. We had a couple of Blackmagic cameras. A small lighting studio, green screen. It was a little rough at first. Our first rough drafts of what we thought we might be able to do were they weren't spectacular yet. So it took a bit.
And as we started digging into that equipment, we found out that those Blackmagic cameras were shooting at like 720. They could get up to 1080. The production software is called Mimo Live. And we were having problems switching. We definitely did not have the lighting we needed. I was zapping different parts of the little studio with my light meter, and I think we're up to 2700 Kelvin with existing lights. And then we had lavalier mics that were like 10 years old. Not good equipment at all. But we were able to film a pilot of what a tele-course might look like. We sent that off to the district and the station, and they swiftly added a mountain of suggestions for making it better.
Right on. Well, what were some of those suggestions that they were bringing up to you?
Yeah, the first obvious one was helping us switch over to a Tricaster. Once we got the Tricaster in place, we had a few of them here in the district that we'd purchased for graduations and other events that we would be doing. And one of our high schools had one in place. And that solved a lot of our jump cut issues and the smoothness and transitions. Everything flowed a lot easier once we got a grasp on the Tricaster software. Beyond that, we also went through quite a few renovations. I think Ben could tell you a little more about that.
Right. Yeah. Well, the station pointed out the obvious stuff, that our audio wasn't up to par, and they gave us all their specs. They also gave us specs in terms of what they expected with the video quality. And so, as Ivan mentioned, the district very quickly reached out to Jeff Bales, the IT guy we're working with. He's a retired IT manager for the district. And I actually reached out to him at the same time too. And so he came in and looked at our setup and right away suggested that we bring the TC1 TriCaster that he used for many years for district graduations and other special events. And so when we got that TC1, we thought about all that we could do with it, setting up multiple cameras, et cetera, overhead cameras. So we moved out of that little tiny room, and I think the room measures 15 feet by like 20 feet, and we moved into the library, and I'm in the library. Massive library, and there's an area that's like 50 feet by 50 feet to my left. That's all tables. We took the tables out. We set up a huge truss with additional lights above. I brought in some of my lights from my education department. And we set up three cameras and then two overhead truss cams. There's a window above, and we blocked out the window with a huge black cloth. And got some Sennheiser lavalier mics from another IT contractor for the district. So immediately that setup put our next pilot tele-course episode into the realm that was viewed as broadcastable, if that's a word, by my station. And so after that, it was fine-tuning minor issues with sound and light. There's not a lot of sound dampening here in the library. We had a lot of issues with sounds of like the air conditioning unit. Mm-hmm. We also had issues with light too, because there are these weird fluorescent lights above, and they were kind of suppressing our light setup. And I think we got up to 4,000 Kelvin here in the library with those additional lights. We also started using our student reporting lab lights, portable lights for field production for the class that Ivan and I have together. We decided, you know what, we need to move into a more controlled environment, and we moved across the hallway into a multi-purpose room, which looks like it could be an old theater. And we set up on the stage there, and there was already a light bar in there with some old Fresnel lights. And so that helped to put us closer to 5,000 K. And then there are all these sound dampening sand panels on the walls, and that helped us out with sound as well. So three studios.
Dang, that's a lot. Y'all did a lot of work, which is, it's all impressive from what I've been watching as well. But one question, because I know you had to do this kind of pretty quick, is how much training did you have prior to like this workflow? You know, because I know that you weren't really necessarily working with TriCasters predominantly. Like, how did you just jump into it to start to absorb all that knowledge?
This was an on-the-job work experience. My background is as a music teacher. I'd never been trained other than about a week of journalism training last year. So it was a crash course. I was really grateful to have Ben and Jeff Bales, our IT consultant, along for the ride, because without them, I don't know what it would have looked like. But on the spot, we were able to figure out how to use the TriCaster software. It took about a week to get really comfortable with it. And then as we went along, we just kept adding more and more features from the TriCaster into it, anything from the virtual studio builder to other aspects. And then the editing side of it too was definitely a learning curve. We did everything in Adobe Premiere Pro. So there was, It was a lot of fun. It was a like professional development in a more most meaningful context.
Sorry.
I was going to say Jeff Bales, our IT consultant. He's a TriCaster maestro, and I knew how to like switch cameras beforehand because I volunteered at RVTV, which is Southern Oregon University's public access studio, and I got their studio certification, and they have a TriCaster there. My station won't let me touch their production control equipment because I'm education department, and I mainly do field production. But so it was really cool to learn how to use the TC1 and take my knowledge, very simple basic knowledge base, up to that next level of learning how to use mix effects. And then Ivan like cracked the, well, to me it seemed like he like hacked the TriCaster system, because there are all these like templates, you know, where it allow you to put a subject in this box and another subject in this. It's kind of like our layout right now. Ivan figured out how to build a layout like this, but from scratch. It was amazing.
That's great. Well, if you need some more information, you can always go to Tuesday Tutorials and I'll teach you some more stuff. Just kidding.
That would be perfect. I'd love it.
So your teachers, from what I've seen, have done a great job using this medium to teach their curriculum. But of course, being in front of a classroom is completely different from being in front of a camera. How do they respond to this transition from a classroom to a stage environment?
Some of our teachers had some experience with TV production in the past, and that really helped a lot because they were able to basically film models or create models that other teachers then could piggyback off of. And they got together and they worked collaboratively as a group on helping each other out with this as well. That made a really big difference in terms of the quality. Once the teachers started collaborating, we started having more experience ourselves to be able to help the teachers in the moment. It really elevated the quality. So we did 8 weeks of episodes, and the difference between the first week and the eighth week was huge. And it had a lot to do with those teachers getting kind of familiar and going on it. By about the end of the second week, by the beginning of the third week of using it, the quality had really started to rise.
That's awesome. Now, not only is this a hurdle for your staff to overcome, but it's also a little bit of a hurdle for your students to overcome as well. How have students been taking to liking this new curriculum and how they're ingesting material?
Yeah, so our students, we live in a fairly rural area, and so some of our students don't have necessarily access to internet service providers, or their internet service is extremely spotty. So this was another way, especially for our youngest kids, to have our pre-kindergarten students, kindergarten, first grade, second grade students, to have access to something that could help enrich their experience with education. They really, it's quite limited in terms of their access in some of our areas. However, because everything was put up on YouTube as well, it's then able to be catalog, so students could go back and use those lessons on their own basis, be able to freeze, pause the videos whenever they needed to be able to get their own resources, their own materials, their own work caught up. So using the different forms of digital media really helped out in this particular project.
That's cool. Now, go ahead. You're about to say.
I was just going to say, now you have to keep in mind that when this all unfolded spring term, the school was thinking in terms of simplicity and grace and not replicating the classroom exactly. They were thinking more of like enrichment curriculum. And so they're now thinking about replicating the classroom and learning management systems as much as possible. So at the time, it was a really cool option that we ran with and worked for that context in spring semester.
Now, a question for you here, because I didn't get all the information that I needed to from the other video, but I know this was also broadcast over the PBS channel, right?
We broadcast episodes on our Channel 8 during primetime, and then there were three other local stations, KTVL, KDRV, and the Dove. Which is a Christian television channel, and they all aired tele-course lesson plans in the morning and evenings. So there were a lot of times that students could watch the same episode in a given week. And then we also published those tele-course lesson plans on our station's YouTube channel and on the district's YouTube channel. And then each of those stations also published those tele-course lesson plans on their YouTube channels as well.
Cool. One of my questions I had on that was, so how did the normal TV audience react to this kind of a change in programming?
We got nothing but positive feedback from our audience. Ivan mentioned something the other day about feedback he got from New York and LA. Ivan, you want to tell us more about that?
Yeah, it was pretty fun because we had families in our local valley that started sharing the content with their family members and friends across the country. And we started getting in emails, messages, thank you notes from all over the US. it was pretty interesting. People just being grateful for another chance for enrichment in ways that their own students weren't having access to in their areas.
That's so cool. So in your highlight reel, I saw some really creative ways of utilizing the TriCaster. For example, you had that one teacher who was flying into the studio. And to be honest, if this was the way that I was learning in school, I probably would have had some better grades if I had that happen. So how has this creativity expanded the way that teachers are presenting their material?
Yeah, so I think some of the most creative things that teachers were able to do. We had a science teacher who really ran with the whole thing, and he ended up producing entire segments on his own and got into the digital graphics and had a blast. Other teachers were able to create a library or a bank of episodes that they now have that can be reused in the future as well. For example, when they have a substitute teacher, they have a fill and play for like a secondary teacher who maybe is teaching the same course six times a day. They have an episode now that they know is meaningful, it's well taught, it's constructed the way they want it, and they can give that to a substitute teacher and say, hey, this is our lesson plan for the day, teach through this video.
Okay, so a lot of these, I mean, was it pretty predominantly just pre-recorded and then playing back, or was there like an interactive element between your students whenever they're watching?
Yeah, this was definitely on the pre-recorded side. For the student interactions, we had students who would interact in the comments. They'd send emails in to teachers asking questions on some of the episodes and things like that. But it was relatively minimal on the student interactions. I wish that was something that we could have gotten into. That would definitely enrich the experience. But yeah, it was definitely more on the pre-recorded side of things.
Okay. Well, the nice thing about it being on demand is I can back it up. And again, being ADHD Richard Evans in like, you know, middle school or something, that would have been so much helpful. Me just go, what did they say again? Sorry, I was doodling something and backing up a little bit. But moving forward, do you plan on integrating this video component into your curriculum as part of your normal routine?
Yeah.
Yeah, we have filmed three SRL tele-course lesson plans. So Ivan and I will definitely have those lesson plans on our learning management system for our SRL class, Student Reporting Labs class, as backups for when students don't make, you know, Zoom calls or students that need to review the, you know, lecture. So we are, and, you know, hopefully during this school year, we can make a pitch to the district to show them that it's a real viable option, even in the scenario that they're going to, where they want to replicate the classroom in a learning management system. So we feel like we can make a case for that this school year.
Yeah, and I can add on to that too. At this point, we know that for teachers in our district, as we go into this next year, we're going to be doing distance learning initially in 6-week segments. And as we're going through that, we're teaching directly to the students over like a Zoom call or some sort of direct interaction digitally for about 3 hours a day. The other 5 hours a day we're dedicating to grading, but also to curriculum development and figuring out how to teach more effectively online. And so I know for sure that we're going to be using this system that we have in our middle school. We're going to be using our TriCaster quite a bit for teachers to be able to construct fully flushed out units. So that way those units can be posted online for students that if they fall sick, they can come back and revisit that material without having to go through, you know, an hour long Zoom call or something like that. They can have more specifically targeted materials. So I think we're calling them asynchronous teaching moments. So moments that will be taken out of time. We'll have these little capsules of preserved, very intentional, very well constructed teaching videos for our students.
And the on-site middle school IT guy, Anthony, he pitched this very idea just the other day to the administrators here. Mm-hmm. And so I have a grant that supports me working with teachers. It's called the Teacher Community Program Grant from PBS. And so if they decide to move forward with that here at the middle school level, I really look forward to using the TriCaster with teachers to film these learning object videos. That's what we call them in our industry, learning object videos, to supplement their curriculum. We could sure use the support from NewTek if we do move into that process.
Yeah, that sounds exciting. That sounds really cool, guys. Like, for real, I really like what y'all are doing. Have you been contacted by like other schools out there to see if they can set something up identical? Because I know y'all are kind of high profile over there a little bit, kind of going viral.
Well, Eagle Point did email me and ask me what it takes to film one of these. And I sent them over a program logic model that I created as a pitch to Medford Schools to keep this thing going for this school year. And so they realized that it's quite the investment because, you know, they don't have a Tricaster. You need a Tricaster, you need the cameras, you need all that networking equipment. You know, you need the space. You need a teacher to do what Ivan did, work double overtime, do his normal teaching job, and then also co-produce with someone else. It's really helpful to have two people in the studio. You know, and then you need teachers that are willing to come in, and you need someone to organize and coordinate all that. So it is a lot of work to make it work out for telecourses. So, which is why I think that the learning object video approach that Ivan mentioned earlier is going to be the way to go in this upcoming school year.
Right on. Kind of tacking on to that, like, how big of a staff did you have when you were producing these? I mean, it seemed like it was pretty minimal, and of course, you want to kind of keep everybody a little bit, you know, socially distant, so to speak.
We basically ran with five. Yeah, Ben and I both did a lot of the filming and direct production. Our IT guy, Jeff Bales, he helped with all those technical things. He was in the building with us beside us, and he helped with some of the filming as well. We had Danielle Craig, a local news anchor, who had been starting her own business, who came in and helped us as a liaison and as a lead editor with our local TV stations, as well as our school buildings. IT guy jumped in and learned how to do the editing in Premiere Pro, and he helped out quite a bit with the editing as well. There was other folks involved as well, our district communications director, and other folks who helped get this project off the ground in the first place. But it was really the five of us that were working on it on a day-to-day basis.
That is super
and then
cool.
The station too, they fine-tuned some of the episodes. Our station editor / cameraman, he did a lot of color work. Because Ivan and I, in our education, we just started getting to learning how to like perfect the color on the cameras, and then also the Tricaster. Jeff showed us, I don't know if it's called the spectrograph, but he started showing us that. And so if the project would have continued through the summer, we probably would have mastered coloring, but the station had to step in there.
Understood. Hey, we get by with a little help from our friends, right?
Right.
Very cool. Another question I wanted to tack on to, because I know it sounds like a lot of work, but what's the most fun thing that you got out of this entire experience?
For me, the best part about this is all the knowledge that I picked up from filming this process that I can then give to my students in the future. It expanded my knowledge base in this area to where I can be a more effective digital media arts teacher for those students that I have. That was a wonderful gift that I get to take with me from this project. Irreplaceable experience of application was wonderful.
I agree with Ivan. The gift was the knowledge of learning the Tricaster. And I'd already been trying to learn about the Tricaster through my volunteer work at RVTV. I reached out to Jeff Bales last year to help with graduation. And unfortunately, I wasn't able to because my schedule didn't work out. But I already had this on my mind. I need to learn more about this amazing piece of equipment. Because I've taken enough tours of enough PBS stations to know that majority of the medium-sized stations out there use the Tricaster. And so from a professional development standpoint, it made a lot of sense for me to get involved in this project. And then also, we were all facing a pandemic that was just taking hold. And we were all in the mode of, let's help students and teachers. And so that's where the primary impetus was this last spring. But moving forward, I really think that we're just scratching the tip of the iceberg relating to the potential of this Tricaster system as a medium that can be joined with education. my imagination runs wild with the things that, you know, we can do, you know, and like when we filmed that episode where that teacher was flying and Ivan figured out how to make that mix effect work. That to me was like one of the most mind-blowing moments of this whole project. And so I know that there's so much more that the Tricaster is capable of. And so I look forward to learning more this year.
That's awesome. Well, Ivan, Ben, thank you so much for your time. What you're doing over there really is taking the reins of this technology to overcome a sticky situation that we're all in and make it a great one. So real talk, y'all are doing some really important work, and I applaud and thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your time.
Well, that's it for this episode of NewTek TV. If you have any questions, please type them into our chat. And be sure to sign up for a free NewTek product demo at newtek.tv and click on the demo button at the top of the screen. Now, as I mentioned during our interview, if you need tips on how to use Tricaster or other NewTek products, we have our Tuesday tutorial video series that you can find on our YouTube page at youtube.com/newtekinc. You can also sign up for our in-depth NewTek learning resource, NewTek University, at newtek.com/newtek-u. And if you're an educator or student and are interested in taking our NewTek University courses for free, send us an email at ntu@newtek.com. And if you've got a story to tell, we want to hear it. So send us an email at newtektv@newtek.com. Also, if you're interested in more information about NewTek products, talk to your local reseller or visit newtek.com. Our next episode will be on August 26th, where we will cover media management for modern video workflows, and we will be joined by Steve McKenna from Studio Network Solutions, and we'll discuss how NewTek remote storage systems are equipping video producers with the tools for multi-stream recording, video playback, asset management, post-production, and so much more. I'd like to thank my guests for joining us today, and I'd like to thank you for watching, and we'll see you next time.